So you probably know by now that my favorite videos to produce are the ones that cover the new features and improvements added to Lightroom every time the team releases updates for its surfaces. So for this video, I'm going to cover everything that was just added to Lightroom Desktop version 8.3. And I'm going to create a separate video covering the improvements added to Lightroom Mobile and Web as well, so stay tuned for that. But for this video, we're going to spend time in Lightroom Desktop because there are some outstanding new features that all of you landscape photographers are going to love. Aside from the features that I'm going to show you, no Lightroom update would be complete without adding support for a host of new cameras and lenses, as well as a healthy list of squashed bugs, one of which I'm actually going to highlight because I am really happy to see it fixed. All right, let's dive in. All right, so you might be wondering why you have a portrait photo on your screen right now. Well, it's because it'll let me illustrate to you the new feature added to Lightroom Desktop 8.3. And I know I said that it was going to be really great for landscape photographers, and it'll make sense in a second. But when you work with a portrait photo and you go to the masking panel here, and Lightroom detects that person in your photo, you'll see this option here for person one. If you have that person named, that name will be applied here. But when you click on that thumbnail, you have the ability to create a mask of the entire person, but more importantly, you can create a mask for each of these individual attributes. So like you can select multiple things and then create separate masks for them and then just make your edits to each mask. So it just speeds up the process. And so hopefully you're kind of following where I'm going with this, because when you think about landscape photography, our landscape photos for the most part have a lot of common attributes. Oftentimes there's a sky, there might be water, there might be mountains, there might be foliage, there might be artificial ground, there might be natural ground. And so for me, one of the things I always would want to do is make edits to those things separately, but it was kind of difficult because we had the adaptive sky mask, but we didn't have any other kind of dedicated mask for landscape photography until now. Now, don't worry, this is a very poorly AI-generated image, but it's good because it allows me to illustrate the new feature. So if we go to masking here, just like we were before, you'll see there is this option here called landscape. And when I select it, Lightroom will now start detecting attributes in the image. And so you can see these are currently all of the attributes that we have. We've got sky, mountains, architecture, vegetation, water, artificial ground, and natural ground. And just like with portraits, we can create separate masks for each of these images. But I'm going to actually work on one of my own photos because I couldn't find an image in my library that generated all of those attributes. So I just wanted to show you them in a list. But now you see, I've got this photo here. Again, this in my last video, I edited a photo from this same location. I just love this area. I love editing photos from this shoot. And so basically, I'm not going to really do much. All I did was I applied adaptive color. If I hit the backslash key, you'll see this is the original photo. This is the image with adaptive color. And I think, yeah, I did a custom white balance. Other than that, I didn't do anything. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to masking here and I'm going to click on landscapes just like before. And you can see it detected 5 attributes. So as I hover over these, you'll see there's water, there's vegetation, there's architecture, mountains, and sky. Now, you might notice that in this situation, both the mountains and the vegetation attributes here, they're kind of similar. So in this situation, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to select sky, mountains, architecture, and water. I'm not going to select vegetation because I don't need that overlap. And just like with the people mask, you'll see here this checkbox to create 4 separate masks. If you don't have that selected, it's just going to create a mask of what you see here with this overlay. So I'm going to go ahead here, enable that, and then select create. And then there are our masks. And so what I want to show you is the reason why I'm so excited about this and why I think a lot of landscape photographers will absolutely love this is because it'll just speed up the workflow. I don't know about you, but for me, if you've watched my videos, you know that for the most part, I'll do a few global edits like changing the profile, getting a white balance, doing like lens correction, those kinds of things. But then I almost immediately after that go to the masking panel because I am a huge fan of localized editing. I love making edits to each section of my image separately. And this new landscape masking tool just makes it so much easier for me to get the selections that I want Because otherwise, it used to take, it didn't take a long time, but it was just a manual process. And I am all for speeding up those kinds of manual processes so I can focus on the creative ones. So you can see with the sky, I'm going to go ahead. You know what I love with sky. I'm going to add a little bit of a dehaze boost over here. I'm also going to increase saturation of that sky. And then using the point curve, just drop the shadows of the sky a bit. So that looks, that looks great right there. I mean, beautiful. Also, one thing I want to point out, if you've watched my videos where I talk about using masks, you know that I always recommend relabeling or naming your masks. Notice how we don't have to do that here. They're already labeled. That makes me very happy. So with mountains, I'm going to select that. We're just going to move down the list. With mountains, what I'm going to do is I'm going to add some clarity, some texture, and I'm also going to warm the temperature slider up a bit. I'm also going to increase saturation. So you can see with that, just adds a nice pop to the kind of hard, rocky surfaces. Then I'm going to go to architecture over here. Architecture, I'm going to make the buildings a little bit brighter. Let's go ahead and add an S-curve to the buildings. Make them pop a little bit more. Something like that. Let's drop refine saturation about halfway down. Let's also increase saturation overall. And I'm going to add a little bit of texture to this. And then finally, let's go to water. So with water, what I'm going to do is add just a tiny bit of a cool temp to the water over there. I'm also going to increase dehaze here. Let's go ahead and increase highlights, open up the exposure a tiny bit, and that's looking pretty good. Now, if I toggle all of the masks, you can see just what a nice job it does, just snapping everything together. And then I could just wrap things up over here by adding, say, my beloved blue primary saturation slider, something like that. Let's go ahead and add some sharpening and remove it from areas where it's not needed. And we will finish things off with a nice little vignette, something like that. And so if I hit the backslash key, that is our original photo. That is our edited photo. And if I wasn't kind of narrating my steps, like I would have had this done in 15, 20 seconds. Like I just feel very comfortable with my editing workflow, and having the landscape masking tools just speeds things up. Because before, what I'd have to do usually is I would go to masking over here, I'd make my sky selection, and then I would duplicate and invert. And then with that inverted mask, I would use combinations of subtract and intersect to kind of refine each of the different areas. But now the landscape masking tool just does the heavy lifting for me, and it just does it very quickly. All right, so I love that landscape masking is now out in the open. I've been using it for a little while now while the feature is being developed, and I'm just really happy that all of you get to enjoy it too. So with that, I would love to know what you think. Leave a comment below. Let me know if you plan on using it, how it's been working for you, because I really do think that this is something that will just speed up and improve editing workflows for landscape photographers. Now, the next feature that I want to show you has to do with sharing improvements. And it's a small thing, but it's also huge. And this is the thing. At the end of this video, I'm going to share another video about why I think using Lightroom to share your albums is such a great experience. And now it's even better. So let me just show you what I mean. So a couple of weeks ago, I went to Adobe headquarters in San Jose, California, and I took photos. Like, here are some photos. This is Lisa Ngo and Katrine Eisman, two wonderful people. You know, just there's Julianne Cost and Chris Ayers, like just all good stuff. This is the Adobe campus. This is the team. We went out for a dinner. This is also the team. And of course, I couldn't not take a photo of the Apple Mac app of the year for 2024 for Adobe Lightroom, which was just like one of the coolest things. So I've got this album here. You can see I've got these photos. And obviously, there were a bunch of other people here too who were taking photos. These are my colleagues on the Lightroom team. And so what if I wanted to share this album, but also give them the opportunity to add their photos so that we all have a shared place to collect photos? Well, now we can do that. So to start, I'm going to go up here and I'm going to click on this icon here. This is an album that I have of photos in my Lightroom Cloud library. I'm going to click on it over here and I'm going to change the link access to anyone can view. And then I'm going to go to settings and here's this new feature. Anyone can upload. I'm going to click on this over here and then I'm going to copy the URL for this shared album. Of course, you have these other options here, like if you want to let people download the JPEGs, which I think is a good idea if you're sharing it with people you know. You can also show or hide the metadata as well as the location. And of course, you can let people add comments and likes. Now, an important point about allowing people to add photos to your album and comments and likes is that the recipients will have to log in with an Adobe ID, which they can create for free, no problems. But you want to make sure that they are logged in because it can get kind of funky if anyone can upload anything. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and click on done. And so I'm going to go ahead to Safari over here, or of course you can use Chrome. I'm going to paste that URL and here is the album. And so just like before, these are all of the images that I showed you. If I click into one, I can download it. But you'll see here on the top over here, there is this add photos button. And so on the desktop here, I've got a few other photos from the trip. And so I'm going to click on add photos. I'll just go ahead and select these images and drop them right there. And then I'm going to click on upload three photos. I can choose to include keywords and GPS coordinates if the images have that. And then I'm going to go ahead and click on upload three photos. And I think this little dialogue here is a nice touch. This is a test account that I use and I'm just using the default profile photo. So I think it's cool that it's kind of prompting you like to change your profile photo, but I'm not going to do that now. I'm just going to click on close and refresh. And so you can now see here that there is something added to the thumbnails. On the bottom right of each thumbnail, you'll see the kind of owner, the thumbnail of the person that uploaded the photos. And so that's kind of why we prompt you to add your own custom photo, because if I did, then it would show here. But it's cool at a glance to see the photos that were added and who added them. More importantly, when I go back to Lightroom over here, you will now see there are these three photos that were added. You can see the little icon over there on the bottom right. To the album. So they're now here in Lightroom as well. So I hope this kind of illustrates why I think sharing your photos using Lightroom can be an excellent experience. And I love that not only do we let others add photos to a shared album, but those photos get brought back into your own Lightroom library. To me, that's just great. And it makes just collecting photos from, say, an event. Let's say you have a party or a wedding or any event. You just create an album in your Lightroom Cloud library, you share it, you enable the ability for everyone to upload, and then just give people the link or a QR code to your album and you're off to the races. So I think it's awesome. We've used it a lot internally and I definitely think you should try it out. So the third feature that I want to show you though is not a feature. It kind of is a feature, but it's actually a bug that we fixed. And for me, this is super important. And it's also super important for anyone else who's ever sent photos from Lightroom to Photoshop as a smart object. So let me show you what I mean. All right, so here I've got this photo here of a reddish egret that I took a few weeks ago. And obviously it's very noisy. And also it's very heavily cropped in. You know, I cropped in just because that's what I wanted here to really focus on the bird in flight. Now, I also made edits to the photo, not many, but you can see this is the original and this is the edited photo, which you can see right here. What I want to do though is I want to send this to Photoshop. For whatever reason, I want to make some edits. Maybe I want to use ACR, which is Adobe Camera Raw. And so usually what I would do is I would go to edit in Photoshop and I would select open as a smart object, because what a smart object allows you to do is preserve the settings of your smart layers so that if you ever have to go back to it, you can and make changes on the fly. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to click on this. And then when I go to Photoshop, you'll see here is the image. And then you'll know it's a smart object by this little icon on the bottom right of the thumbnail here in the layer. And if I double click it, it's going to open up in Adobe Camera Raw. And here is where the fix is. Before, we would rasterize the image when we sent it from Lightroom to Photoshop as a smart object. What that meant is when you open the image in Adobe Camera Raw, all of your Lightroom edits were lost. These would all be zeroed out, which is not a good thing. So I wanted to highlight this. It's really important to me, and it's a big enough thing where I wanted to actually include it in this video so that those of you who do use this workflow where you send your photos from Lightroom to Photoshop as a smart object, you can now rest easy knowing that this comes in and it preserves these settings. Not only will it preserve your settings from Lightroom, but if you enable HDR, which puts the image into a 32-bit mode, before, if you sent it as a smart object and it rasterized, it would come into Photoshop as a 16-bit TIFF and it would lose that information. Now, if you have HDR enabled and you send it as a smart object, it will retain the 32-bit information, which is great. Now, speaking of the workflows between Lightroom and Photoshop and Adobe Camera Raw, Lightroom Desktop 8.3 has a really nice improvement related to things like Gen Expand and AI denoise and super resolution. I'll show you what I mean right now. So if I go into Photoshop here and I open up that same, I just exported that raw file that I just worked on. So you could see right here, it opens up in Adobe Camera Raw. Now let's say I go ahead and I apply AI denoise, which is right over here. One of the nice things about using denoise in Adobe Camera Raw is that it doesn't create a derivative DNG the way it works in Lightroom. So in Lightroom, when you apply denoise, you'll get a new DNG file. Here, it's not doing that. It's actually working with the raw file. So you can see here, I have my image with noise reduction applied. And then I'm also going to go to crop over here. I'm gonna enable expand and I'm gonna do a little bit of gen expand. Let's say I want this to be a little bit larger like this, and I want to put the bird more on kind of the right third. I'll go ahead and click on generate, see what the variations are. That one looks good. I'm going to click on keep. And then I'm also going to click on this update all just to make sure that the adaptive profile is re-rendered since we made some changes to the pixel masks. And so now I'm going to click on done, and I'm going to quit out of Photoshop over here. And here's the thing. If I go to Lightroom and I go to local, I'll go to desktop, you'll see here's the change. Now, Lightroom will render things like Gen Expand and the denoise that was applied in Adobe Camera Raw. It didn't do that before, but now it can actually do that. It can render those changes, which I think is really huge. All right, so I've got one more bonus feature, but it doesn't have to do with Lightroom. It has to do with Adobe Camera Raw, but it is one of the more popular new tools that we've announced recently, and that is reflection removal. Up until now, reflection removal only worked with supported RAW and DNG files, but now you can use JPEGs and HEIFs. So check this out. I'm going to take this JPEG over here. Huge thanks to my coworker and friend, Katrine Eisman, for giving me this wonderful image that has just a bunch of reflections. I'm going to take this and I'm just going to open this up into Photoshop, and I'm going to go to filter and select Camera Raw filter over here. This is where we just were basically, but now if I go to the remove panel and expand reflections, we now can apply it. Now, of course, you'll want to make sure you go into the gear icon here, select technology previews, and enable this option for new AI features and settings panel. And it goes without saying, but this is Camera Raw 17.3. That is the latest version. If you're running 17.2 and you open an image with reflections up, that's a JPEG, it won't let you apply it. So you'll want to make sure you're in 17.3. So I'm going to go ahead and click on apply over here. And then boom, this is magical, the fact that we can do this on a JPEG now. We also have a quality dropdown so you can adjust the quality threshold for the reflection removal. And just like before, I can either show you the reflected image, or if I go to negative 100, I can see kind of the anti-reflected image, which is also super cool. But I think most people will just want to see the reflections removed. And so those are the key new features added to Lightroom Desktop version 8.3. I mean, I give the Lightroom team so much credit. They work so hard and they do some really amazing things. So I hope you're excited to use these new features. Remember, just go to the Creative Cloud Desktop app and make sure you're running the latest versions. Let me know what you think of them in the comments below. Of course, if you want to learn absolutely everything there is to know about Lightroom Desktop, mobile, and web, please do check out my course called Lightroom Everywhere. Link is in the description below. And I mentioned that I have this video that explains why you should be using Lightroom to share your photos. Check that out. Of course, if you found this video helpful, a thumbs up is always appreciated and it helps the channel. Be sure to click on the subscribe button and the bell icon to get notified of all future videos. Thanks a lot, everyone.